your practice strategy for Canvas Software? We're a outsourcing partner. I've scattered some brochures around, so if you happen to see one, if you want to talk to me about any projects that you're working on, we're software development partners, and we have a lot of good skills in building software, deploying to the cloud, and in DevOps. Personally, I have graduate degrees in computer science, mathematics, and oddly enough, psychology. I have been a technology journalist and university professor and technical evangelist also. So I'm a distance runner and I'm a cat dad. There they are. So how many of you have either read the book Moneyball or seen the movie Moneyball? A number of you, that's pretty good. I recommend both because they actually focus on very different things. The topic is similar, but it's more, the movie's more of a human interest story. Then many of you probably know that Moneyball is about baseball. It's about fielding, it's about pitching, and it's especially about offense. But even more than being about baseball, Moneyball is also about building great teams. So we're going to talk for the next 25 minutes or so about applying some of the principles of Moneyball to building great teams. So if you know the story, you probably know this, but at the end of the 1990s, the Oakland Athletics had a problem. They had by far the lowest payroll, the amount of money they could allocate to paying players in professional baseball, in Major League Professional Baseball. So they had about $8 million to spend a year on their payroll. In contrast to the highest paid team, which is?
The New York Yankees.
Yeah, the Yankees at the same time were paying over $200 million for their payroll every year. And so Billy Beane, who was the general manager, the new general manager of the Oakland A's, described this as saying, there are rich teams, and there are poor teams. Then there's 50 feet of crap, and then there's us. So he needed to figure out how to build a team, how to build an effective, competitive team, while not being able to compete in paying for talent at the various baseball positions. So he went back, and this was at the time also where large amount of data started to become available on individual players, on teams, on situational baseball, and things like that. And he went back and he hired some statisticians, he hired some finance guys, he hired people who were comfortable looking at numbers and drawing conclusions from numbers. And he discovered something very interesting. He discovered that baseball experts didn't know a number of things, and the so-called expert scouts didn't know a number of things. They looked for classic features in a baseball player. They wanted somebody who could run, they wanted somebody who could hit for average, hit for power, and field. He discovered that not all of those things contributed equally to building a great team. And three conclusions that he did come to at that very top level was getting on base is highly correlated with winning games. The more players, yeah, it seems obvious in retrospect, doesn't it? But he discovered that, and you didn't have to get on base by hitting for power or hitting for average. You could draw a lot of walks. You could draw a lot of hit by pitches. So there were a lot of different ways of getting on base. It did not necessarily mean hitting for power or hitting for average. Pitching is secondarily important, but it's not a game changer, really. And fielding, last of all, is very overrated. So he discovered that, in general, data wins out over expert judgment. And why is that? It's because we're biased. It's because we have certain preconceived notions about just what constitutes success. And in being biased, we choose our team with our biases in mind. So what we're going to do over the next few minutes is look at some of these biases, not all of them by any means. I'm going to pull out some for examples. So what does this have to do with DevOps? We do maintain certain beliefs in our practice, and bias can affect our results. One of the things that I like to say is that we are biased towards wanting to work with people who are pretty much like ourselves. We spend 8, 10, 12 hours a day at work. We want to be around people who are pretty much like ourselves, because that'll make us feel comfortable, help us get in the zone and all that. And also, we want to work on products that we want to use. Well, guess what? If you want to work with people who are pretty much like ourselves, and if we want to build products that we want to use, we don't have a company, we have a club. So we want to eradicate biases. We want to recognize, first of all, those biases, and we'd like to get rid of them, because most successful companies bring in diversity, dare I say that word, diversity, and also bring in, also listen to their customers rather than build what they want to build. We can focus on the wrong things. We may not, in our practice, in our daily practice, we may find mistakes, or we may find small, false mistakes. We do too many activities by rote, by checklist. We have our checklist. Guess what? Checklists are good under some circumstances, but they may not help us actually solve a problem. We work too hard and become fatigued. How many of you are working or have worked for a startup company? I have. I learned one very important lesson, one important life's lesson in working for a startup company. And that lesson was, you can only work 100-hour weeks for a maximum of 6 months before you really start losing it. So let's take a look at human error. And I believe John Willis, I don't know if John's here today, but I believe that John Willis mentioned Daniel Kahneman. Daniel Kahneman is a very interesting character. Does anybody know who Daniel Kahneman is? A number of you. That's pretty good. Well, Daniel Kahneman, first of all, is a research psychologist. He's in his 80s right now, and Thinking Fast and Slow was his seminal work of several years ago, basically his life's work codified in a book from several years ago. And he's a psychologist who is a very unique one in that he won the Nobel Prize in economics. Does anybody remember why? He proved that the theory of the rational investor is wrong. That investors are not rational, that they have biases, that they follow their instincts, that they're not rational. Whether individually or as a group, they don't act rationally. Kahneman defined two different types of thinking. System one thinking is very fast, intuitive, but sometimes wrong. We make instantaneous decisions, but they're right enough. System two thinking, which is slower, more deliberate, more accurate. So I kind of like to give you an example here of system one thinking. Bat and the ball cost $1.10. The bat costs $1 more than the ball. How much does the ball cost? Quick.
5 cents.
Oh, that's good. You guys are good. You guys are good. The most common answer I get with that question is, of course, 10 cents. But that doesn't follow the rules, because if the bat costs 10 cents, if the ball costs 10 cents and the bat costs $1 more than that, that means not that the bat and the ball together cost $1.10, it means they cost $1.20. $1 more than the ball. Instead, it's 5 cents and it's $1.05. But instinctively, we fight against that. If I ask for an immediate answer, many people will get that question wrong. Instead of system one thinking, we use system one thinking hundreds of times a day. I'm getting ready to step out on the curb out here, and I don't know, maybe something catches my the corner of my eye, or maybe I hear a noise or something like that, and I pull back. Why do I do that? Well, a car comes whizzing by. Or not, but you want to know something? I play on the safe side. If I see something out of the corner of my eye, my instinct is to pull back. I may be wrong, but you want to know something? Pulling back is better than completing my step out. System one thinking keeps us functioning. They're fast decisions, they're usually right enough. But system one is in fact gullible and guy. System two, we have to think about. If I ask you to add together two very large numbers, most of us can't do that instinctively. Most of us are not math savants. We can't do that instinctively. Instead, we have to work it through in our mind. But guess what? That means that we have to consciously engage system two. We have to consciously engage our intellect. And that takes some effort to do so. So what kind of errors can we make either by not engaging system two thinking or by overusing it? Kahneman in Thinking Fast and Slow lists dozens of errors and dozens of biases. Just out of example, I pull out four of them here that I'd like to go through pretty quickly. Priming, the halo effect, heuristics, and regression to the mean. I think these are some of the more important ones that we in software and we in DevOps have to deal with. System one can be influenced by things that just happen that may be on the top of our mind right now. For example, if I ask you, what do you think of your financial situation? And you say, you know, oh my God, I just lost my job. I don't know where my next rent check is coming from. I'm not sure what I'm going to eat after this week. And then I ask, are you happy? Guess what? I primed you for a negative response. You're no longer happy. Instead, I primed you for a negative response. Alternatively, you may answer, hey, I just inherited $10 million. I'm buying a loft down the village, and I think I'm pretty much set for life. And then I ask, are you happy? You think, yeah, I am. I primed you once again for a positive response. If we have preconceived notions, if I say, if you come onto a team, and I say, this is the best team I've ever worked with, this is the best team in the company, they're all top-notch, they work together well, and you start finding errors in some of the scripts, so you start finding errors in deployment, you start finding bad decisions made on tool chains and workflows and things like that, what are you going to think? You're going to think, well, they know what they're doing, so maybe it's me that has the problem here. Maybe my skills are not up to par. So on the other hand, if you come onto a team and you're told, you need to bring this team up to speed because they're really screwing up, then if you start finding errors, you're already pre-programmed to find them. Halo effect. If we have our first impression is favorable or unfavorable, but that first impression oftentimes influences what we think of later. We want our first impressions to be correct. And I tend not to be political, but I'm going to say that half the country, more or less, voted for Donald Trump. A large proportion of that population still has a favorable view of him. Now, once again, I'm not passing any judgment here or anything like that, but if you voted for somebody, you would like to believe that they're doing a good job. And once again, if we're introduced to a team and we have favorable first impressions of the team members, they're all friendly, they all want to help me, they want me to fit in, they value my opinion, things like that, and you find out that they're making a lot of incorrect decisions, a lot of biased judgments and things like that, you may say, well, that's not so important. Instead, I still like these people. I still like working with these people. We can fix these problems. How do we control for this? We measure. We collect numbers. Our facts and our metrics need to help us make the decision. Don't try to explain, just point to the numbers. I had a friend who, in his first teaching experience, online teaching experience, they have to run all the students' papers through plagiarism checkers. And he ran this one student's paper through a plagiarism checker, and and discovered a very high probability of plagiarism. And so he's writing an email to this student in which he says that, you know, I have to run this through the plagiarism fact checker, and you came out with a very high percentage. I'm sorry, you're a plagiarist. He showed it to me before he said it. And I said, everything is fine except take out that last sentence. That judgment is above your pay grade. You're just focused on the facts of the matter. And what are you going to do about it? I have to turn this over to the Administrative Review Committee. But you do not draw that judgment. Don't try to explain what happened. Just focus on the facts. Just a fax mail. Anybody remember Dragnet? All right. Heuristics. What's a heuristic? It's a rule of thumb. It's we have, based on our past experience, we have a set way of evaluating and dealing with particular situations. We don't have to think, we're able to quickly evaluate the situation, compare it to something similar that we've done in the past, and make a decision. This is, in fact, System 1 thinking in action. And heuristics are usually, are sometimes good, but we have to, not draw that immediate judgment. We have to say, is this really the same situation that we faced with before? We have to engage our system in thinking, even as we're using rules of thumb. I have an example. Do any of you here fly? Have pilot's licenses, anything like that? I do. A couple of you. I got my private pilot's license when I was 17 years old, which is about 5 years ago. One of the experiences that you have to go through to get a private pilot's license with an instructor pilot is they do an exercise called putting you under the hood. They put this mask over your face, it flips down and covers your eyes. The instructor pilot puts the plane in an unusual attitude. It may be a steep bank, it may be an unsustainable climb, something like that. And then he'll flip up the hood so you can see the instruments. You can't see out, but you can see the instruments. Your job is to recover that plane as quickly as possible only by using the instruments. After a couple times doing this, I developed a heuristic. I would look at the turn and bank indicator, and I would look at the airspeed. And I would bring the plane to straight and level flight based entirely on my reading of those two instruments within seconds. I was quite proud of myself. I developed a heuristic that would get me out of trouble flying. Well, after about 5 or 6 times of this, the instructor pilot realized what I was doing, so he did this once in a while. And then he flipped up the hood, and I'm looking at the turn and bank indicator and the airspeed indicator. And I get the turn and bank indicator centered. We're not in a turn anymore. And our airspeed's fine, but there's something wrong. I'm fighting the controls. It's not flying straight and level. And I start looking at some of the instruments. And it turns out we're losing 1,200 feet a minute. Yeah. Even though the airspeed is fine and the turn and bank indicator is fine. How did this happen? And guess what? I could not even at that point in time, a heuristic failed. I could not even at that point in time engage my system to thinking to be able to start over again and figure out the problem. My mind shut down completely. I could not even evaluate the problem. He said, well, what are you going to do? And I said, I think we're going to crash in about 3 minutes. So heuristics are good, but we also need to engage that system to thinking to say, is this situation really similar to the one that we faced in the past? Regression to the mean. When I praise a good performance, the next time it's not as good. But when I criticize a poor performance, it improves the next time. Well, guess what? This means that this means not that complimenting somebody is bad and criticizing them is good. It means that we have variability. We have skill and luck. Our performance varies. Praise or criticism for exceptional performances won't matter. But we believe in the value of experts. Experts will tell us when they make a right decision. They won't remind us of all the incorrect ones they made. We take credit for the positive outcomes. So that raises the question, are expertise and expert intuition real? Yes, but only under certain circumstances. A static domain, and if that expert has worked years to develop that expertise. But even experts don't always realize the limits of that expertise. And about those statistics, we don't believe that they apply to our circumstance. 50% of the projects fail. Well, mine's going to succeed. Or here's another good one. We will keep to the schedule this time. Oh, Winkle, that trick never works. So let's go back to DevOps. Your team matters. You don't want to be working with people who think and behave and have similar skill sets to you. The DevOps engineer is, in fact, the anchor, but don't overload on skills that make sense, that you feel comfortable working with. And, in fact, I'll go so far as to say that generalists make the best DevOps practitioners. Automation. Automation is more than simply an ROI calculation. Automation makes our processes consistent, standardizes them. Automation is important for a lot of the things that we do that we don't have to think about. But once again, we need to step back and evaluate, is our automation working for us? Are there better ways to do this? Formulas versus judgment. Formulas usually win, but expert judgment, if they have the same data as a formula, the expert can sometimes add value, and it can produce a better result. So don't completely discount expertise, even as you're looking at the data. We tend to estimate badly. In fact, we always say, despite the fact that we failed at something 9 times in a row, this time's a charm, the 10th time's a charm. Use your data, but lose the confidence. Regression to the mean is a big fallacy. We tend to want to assign credit or blame. Okay, for doing really well, oh, our DevOps team solved this problem in 30 minutes. Good job, folks. Oh, they can't find the problem. Bad job, folks. Variations should not be assigned cause. They simply have. So let's try to build this into building great teams. We want to minimize the errors in judgment. We want to recognize and reduce bias. And also recognize and eliminate groupthink. My colleague Jerry Owen is going to be talking about giving an Ignite on groupthink this afternoon. So I strongly recommend that you find out more information from her on groupthink. You keep people sharp by not continually building a stressful environment. Preconceived expectations of success or failure or biases. Try to keep those expectations to a minimum. Once a team, for example, has come to an agreement on a course of action, turn the tables by saying, what can go wrong here? So you get people thinking in the opposite direction. Expertise is good up to a point, but experts need to understand and accept the limits of their expertise, and they shouldn't be shy about saying, this is outside of my area of expertise. And experts shouldn't be the ones making the decisions. They can provide input, but both they and we must also be willing to work from the data. So in conclusion, become skillful at DevOps development, testing, deployment, monitoring. Try to learn broad rather than deep. You're a team that has broken down silos. Learn something of the other people's skills also. And so, because you may have to fill in for them from time to time. And instead, do seek jacks of all trades. Sometimes you need that expertise, but the best team members are oftentimes those that can contribute in multiple areas. So, we are influenced by a variety of biases and thinking errors. Understanding how people think can help us recognize and adapt to those errors. We can adapt our approach to account for those errors, and expertise does matter, but don't rely on expertise as a be-all, know-all, and solve-all. A little bit more for more information. I will have this up. I think it's already up on SlideShare. If not, I'll have it up there within the next day or so. Any questions? Yes?
So Kahneman also says when he interviewed him, he says, oh, great, here are all these biases. How do we overcome all this stuff? And he goes, I really can't. And I guess it's like, wow, he pointed out these things, but like, how do you set up those nudges and checks, and what are some of the ways that at least sometimes kind of, that's what I struggle with.
Yeah, you know, I think though the recognizing that we're doing it is half the battle, really. Okay, thank you very much. You have a question?
What did the instructor done to the plane?
I'm sorry?
What had the instructor done to the plane?
He crossed the controls. We were in a slip, which is an excellent way of losing a lot of altitude in a hurry. Thank you very much.